Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hero Movie Podcast, your greatest source for superhero movie discussion in the multiverse. I'm your host, Adam Portress, and joining me today, he's all pain and no Jane, sweet Shonza Kovacs from the internet.
That's pretty good.
Nice. And you should see him in his red wig, Bruce Leslie.
I'm a prickly pear. Guys, they can't all be winners.
No,
sorry.
They can't. But or maybe can they? Who knows? Don't show your hands too early in this thing, because everybody, this week we are talking Painkiller Jane from 2005. Now, last week I said 1995, but if you look at the poster on Tubi, I think my faux pas would be understood.
Yeah, it's 2005.
Because it looks like a 1995 poster, to be sure. But it's a little bit more advanced than that. But what we're going to be covering, Painkiller Jane this week. And I also realized this while I was looking and doing all the art and stuff for today's show. Which, by the way, if you don't see the updated art every week, just go to like new. I'll remember the website by the name of the newpodcastapps.com. That's it. And get one of those apps. But new artwork comes up every single week if you have one of those. And I was putting all the art together. There is a Painkiller Jane from like. Just recently, so we got another one of these hot ones coming in,
and yeah, it's a reboot.
Yeah, with Christina Hendricks. No, wait, the girl.
No,
it was the girl that was in the Terminator flick, the Terminator 4.
Oh, that's 2007
or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah, that's the 2007 one. But there's also a Jimmy Palmiotti says he has another version in production with Jessica Chastain attached.
Oh my word! Well. It feels like we're just going to milk this till the cows come home, but don't worry
about
that.
Look, I'm not going to call Mr. Palmiotti a liar, but sure.
Hey, you don't know me. I got things I'm doing over here. Sometimes I'm making a comic. Sometimes I'm lying about stuff that's coming up on my slate. Shut up.
I love the idea of having Jimmy Palmiotti sound like somebody who's like doing a bad Brooklyn accent. I do love that idea.
Yeah. Funny. I mean, he's from Brooklyn, which makes it funny.
Yeah, it's close enough. Why not? Yeah. But before we do get into the show and everything, we do want to say a big thank you to the people who support us over at patreon.com/HMP. Doesn't matter what level you join up at. You get pre-show, post-show, dingers zone. And we, of course, get to vote every single month on a movie that we watch. And boy, do we have a, we'll call them a set of films for you this month.
Technically, that is correct.
They meet the legal definition for moving pictures.
Exactly. It's at least 24 frames a second, and the sound is at least partially enough in sync. So here are the choices that we have to choose from. Super Fuzz. Now, did we find out where that was at? If it's at someplace? Maybe if not, we'll have to buy it.
I right now, all I know is that it's 99 cents on Amazon.
Well, all right. We'll break the bank for that one. That's why we have the people at Patreon for those 99-cent rentals. Super Bob. That's available on Tubi right now. The next choice is Ultraman Geed. That's G-E-E-D. I'm not mispronouncing that. That's correct. Geed, the movie, Connect the Wishes. What a fantastic title. That's available on Netflix. Now, the Marvel Japanese Spider-Man, we're going to do the episodes 1 through 3. That's actually available on archive.org, which we were kind of surprised
Spider-Man.
About. Full episodes, like full episodes, full season there and everything, Bruce?
That's what it said, 43 episodes or something.
Unbelievable. So we'll be covering the first couple of those, if indeed you vote on that one. And the last one for voting this month, Defender, that's starring Woody Harrelson. That is also available on Tubi. Check all those out. Check out the IMDb's for them and stuff like that. Make a good, solid, logical choice and head on over to patreon.com/HMP. Vote on those. Help support this show and get yourself some more content in the meantime. And of course, if you can't do that, please join us over at the iTunes or anywhere else you have a review system available to you. Drop us a 5-star review, aka Humdinger. And we'd really appreciate that from all of you fine folks. Just do that. Grab your grandma's cell phone, write a review. That's how it works. There is no trailer for Painkiller Jane, as I looked at.
Adam, if I may. It's time to retire the grab your grandma's cell phone bit.
And listen, we've had at least two people do it, so.
Right, but what I'm trying to say to you is it's time to get some different stuff to say there.
He's going to regret this next week. All right.
It's right up there with the, you can see this with some adult beverages
all right.
thing. I mean, you're right there.
Guess what? It's gone out of the repertoire, and when we get no more reviews, you'll understand.
We'll still get reviews.
That's fine.
We're depending heavily on stolen grandma reviews at this point.
I think that's pretty much the statement we're trying to get at here. So no trailer for Painkiller Jane. So let's do this. It's time for Bruce's comic book connection. Is there a comic book involved in this?
Oh man, I threw a bunch of jelly beans in my mouth because I thought you were going to play a trailer.
No.
But
this ought to be well,
good thing you're eating while you're on an audio recording.
No, we usually have those 20-minute boring trailers.
Well, trust me, I looked for some trailers and I could find nothing. Would you like Sean to do a quick reaction?
Good now. Painkiller Jane is a character created by Jimmy Palmiotti and first drawn by Joe Quesada. So she has a pretty darn good creative lineage. She first appeared in 22 Brides number 1, published by Event Comics, way back in 1996 when the Macarena was the hottest song on the radio and Independence Day was ruling the box office. The time was ripe for a female hero who was virtually indestructible. Of course, Jane Vasco was that hero. The catch is, despite her remarkable healing ability, the injury still hurt like the Dickens, thus her name, Painkiller Jane. Jane's origin story is not real clear. In fact, more than one version of it has been told as the character traveled to various publishers. But the basics are she was a cop working undercover trying to infiltrate the mob. A bomb was planted on her. It exploded and she was miraculously revived somehow and suddenly had her superpower. Palmiotti figured the origin story didn't matter if the main character did enough tush whooping, and a real whoop tush she was. Jane left the cops behind and became a streetwise vigilante. Painkiller Jane not only went on to have her own ongoing comics at Event Comics, Dynamite, and Icon, but she also had featured crossovers with the likes of Ash, Vampirella, and Hellboy, making her an indie comic darling. Jane usually covers herself in bandages to both hide her identity and soak up all the blood she inevitably spills in her dust-ups, giving her a cool yet intimidating appearance. From the best I can tell, Jane last appeared sometime in the mid-20-teens, but with Palmiotti behind the typewriter, she's a tough cookie who can splash back onto the scene at any moment. And speaking of splashing back onto the scene, Adam, do you have a list?
Oh, man, get your towel ready because this is going to be splashing everywhere all on you, because if that comic connection wasn't enough, let me tell everybody, this made-for-TV movie, it got everything. We got the Universal logo and theme. It's been so long since we've had a quality top-tier, one of the big boys for one of these movies, but do not worry, it still looks like an asylum film. We've got a proper swing set, barrette and leather jacket action, a director of photography, Stephen McNutt, who would go on to shoot Battlestar Galactica. We, of course, have Shaft, the highest cheekbones in the army, black eyes, the darkest doll's eyes, bleeding from every orifice, guys in white hazmat suits that I first thought were dudes in polar bear costumes, but that was mostly because the camera was out of focus. We got gunshot to the head. You've never seen so many people who clearly do not know how to shoot guns. Self-healing wounds, a character who does not have one of the strongest things ever upon first meeting him. He tells you that he's a coward. Those are his exact words. We got Doc Ock glasses, montage, including a green Bacta tank. We got sections for commercials that Tubi somehow does not want to put commercials in. No, they'd rather put commercials in the middle of the cut. You know, just, hey, Adam, we're just going to put rads in the middle of places. Is that all right? No, Rebecca, it's not okay. You know, it's not as many ads as Midnight Pulp, so that's fine. We got great lines of science like, I want to know how she does it, and I want to know how to replicate it. And marvel to such classics as, you may not like what you hear. We got scenes from A Beautiful Mind, scenes that'll make Flash and Daredevil blush, horrible running form, hand-stabbing, white tank top wearing, motorcycle riding. Fashion choices include leather jacket wearing, fatigues, and a beret. Painkiller Jane does her best red hair Karen cosplay years before that was actually a thing, so put some respect on that, if you will. We got fog machines and steady cams. We've got more references than you can shake a stick at. Jerry Springer, E.T., Area 51, Brother from Another Planet, The Sixth Sense, Bobby Fischer, SpongeBob, Super Mario Brothers, a Tupac and Biggie reference, really. We got a regular Quentin Tarantino movie on our hands over here. You spent half this movie like wanting these two people to get it on already. It's like a song that takes forever to get to the chorus. We got a helicopter ride over DC and the end, spoiler alert, Shaft goes fishing. This movie has everything.
Now, you did mention that it was a Universal production, but you should point out it's Universal Television
Yeah, it's, you know, it's got Universal on there.
It's still Universal, but it did premiere on the Sci-Fi Channel. That's why it looks like a sci-fi
show. Oh, yeah, that explains why it looks exactly like a sci-fi show. And and it was clearly shot in Canada because you have so many Canadian actors on this show. And Bruce, I've got to tell you, this is probably the best thing I can remember you suggesting.
Oh,
that's not necessarily a compliment.
No, I'm saying I think it is. I mean,
because I've not had a great track record with my recommendations.
It feels like you're watching an episode of MacGyver for sure. Like if MacGyver were shot in Canada. But it isn't and it's not something where like I'm just hate watching this thing till the end. I mean, it's not great. It's a sci-fi TV show, but it's like, it's also not terrible. And also, as somebody who has perfect wigdar, when you can tell that somebody is wearing a wig, even though they are a football field away from the camera,
you gotta love that.
Maybe it's time to change. If your wig is like Woody Harrelson as Carnage level dad,
beautiful. Yes.
Maybe you need to change that wig. Maybe you don't have a wig at all. Maybe you just use her same hair because she looks absolutely ridiculous when that change comes. When she's, I guess she's supposed to be like a foxy mama as soon as she like makes the big change, but she looks like she should be in Can't Hardly Wait.
Was such a downgrade. This woman is beautiful. She really is so good looking, and you're watching it the entire time, and you're almost distracted by her beauty, going like, I don't even care if she can act. She's so good looking.
I think it also says a lot that even though this was clearly intended as a pilot for a show that wouldn't come around for 2 years later with everyone recast and the story rebooted, but she didn't have enough confidence in the project to actually cut her hair for the for the hair change.
Look,
and I don't blame her. Good decision making by Miss Emmanuelle Vaugier, I think is her name.
Unless this thing goes to series, I'm not cutting this hair.
Exactly. That was exactly my thought. It's like, we'll see if this pilot movie takes off.
It looks so much like a wig. I was expecting it to be explained in story that she disguised herself with a wig.
No, I thought it was too. I thought there was just like, oh, well, she's decided to don this wig.
She's
going to
pull the wig off and say, look, it was me all along.
No.
Unfortunately, they forced this $15 cancer wig on this lady and were like, get out there, go in front of camera.
I'm mysterious and no one knows who I am except that, like, why? And also, if you're trying to, you know, blend in, do you go fire engine red?
They watched X-Men 2 and the only thing they took away from it was Storm's wig.
You know what I watched recently was that GQ puts out where it's like a GQ asks an expert. Mm-hmm. And so one of the experts was talking about the disguise work in movies and television and whether disguises are good, like these disguises are good or bad. And when they got to Alias, she said that's the best thing that lady can do because she's already really pretty. So you go crazy looking and all anyone's going to see is the crazy looking. They're not going to see, you know, that, oh, this is a really good looking girl. And Alias did that a lot. And so I kind of get this, that's the way they're going with Painkiller Jane. Although let's be fair, that's not why they did that. They thought it's 2005. Let's put an Affliction t-shirt on that lady and some bootcut jeans and we're ready to go.
It was a really half-butt attempt at trying to make her in the third act there at the end of the movie look like the comic book character, but it didn't work that great.
This character feels like it's straight out of the 90s Gen 13 kind of character.
1996, man.
That makes sense.
I never read any of the books. Like that's one of those, again, that's another one of those wizard books that you just kind of see in the pages of Wizard to talk about. And you're like, oh, that's a book I'll never read, but I know of its existence.
But yeah, she had the red hair with that same kind of cut. The sunglasses, but she didn't wrap the bandages around herself. That's what she needed to really try to pull out the comic book look.
I loved how all of her special powers kind of are just shown to us and everything from the, but really
With no real explanation, because I don't think even the people writing or directing or making this movie quite knew what her powers were, but she could look at things and know stuff, but it wasn't really precognition or anything. You're just supposed to think her mind worked fast, but maybe not. Maybe it was. I don't know, man. I don't, like, she didn't have any of that power in the comics. It was just the healing power, and the rest was just her being like a female version of the Punisher.
Okay. Well, this is during the age of Chuck, where, like, we're going to make the power set as bland and as amorphous as possible so that we can just have her do whatever we need her to do for the script. There's a lot of that happening in this show. Also, Eric Dane is on the show. And I got to tell you, I recognize him as Multiple Man. But the lady who I cohabitate with comes into the room and she goes, "Oh, that's McSteamy."
Oh, from the Grey's Anatomy, the show that surprisingly is still on the air.
We talk about zombie versions of The Simpsons and stuff. That show is the lady version of
original band member left in that bad boy.
Except for the main character. And she's like, "You know what? I'm going to ride this out now. We're going to go until I'm 70.
Hey, sometimes that's what you got to do, man. If you just get in that point, you're like, well, we're this far in. You might as well coast that bad boy to the end.
Are you kidding me? That's exactly what I would do. But you know, Eric Dane.
She's going to Perry Mason this thing.
Eric Dane is this. He's on Grey's Anatomy for 9 years and then makes the shift over to Euphoria because he's on that show now, which is a show that's like super hot. And that's probably going to go for a couple of years. This dude has really gone from like, this is Canada's best looking man to, you know, now I'm just a dude who just collect paychecks. That's all I do now. Hell no. I think he actually, unfortunately for Painkiller Jane, the lady playing Painkiller Jane, she seems like she's a fairly competent actress. She's just not right for this part. But
then she's actually had some legitimate like career. She's from Vancouver. That's probably the number one thing in getting cast in this.
Sure.
But yeah, she's been on like other stuff, I guess.
You could see her in a ton of TV work.
She was in Saw 2 and Saw 4, Adam. I thought you might have seen those.
Oh, was she? Listen, all the victims in the Saw movies are just, you know, puppets. They're just meat puppets. About
winning comic book stuff made for TV. She was on Human Target.
Oh, I liked Human Target. We always talked about reviewing that. I don't even know if you could find that anywhere these days.
Yeah, well, that's the thing where the concept to it is so much better than the actual.
It's true.
Products.
It gets there and it's like, oh, well, this is a really neat idea. And then it kind of falls off. And I feel like the same thing kind of applies with this is like, there's an idea here, but the execution on it is really just overall lacking.
I mean, basically what you need to make with that show is you need to make Tom Cruise's Mission Impossible movies. Like that's basically what you need to do on that show. And it's never that. Anyway, getting back to the topic at hand. So Richard Roundtree's in this movie, and I didn't realize this. Basically, in the early 2000s, Asylum kind of does this now, where, you know, we're going to cast a TV show. You're not going to know a single person on the show except for the one ringer we've got.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And in this show, it's Richard Roundtree, basically. And we'll get to Tate Donovan in a minute. But Richard Roundtree is the ringer. And Asylum now does that with all of their movies where they're like, okay, you're not going to know a single person. And then here you go. Here's Urkel.
Yeah.
And my
money. I got to say, though, I think Roundtree turned in the best performance on this movie.
Yeah, because he's the best actor on the show. I mean, yeah.
Hey, but Painkiller Jane was on some seasons of CSI as a detective. Look,
I don't think she's a bad actress. I just think that she's poorly cast in this. She's not, you know, like she's not a tough as nails lady that you think is going to, you know, like, clearly she was in charge of her own unit in Afghanistan. Like, no. That is not who this lady is.
Apparently, one of the actors was in something called Da Vinci's Inquest.
Hmm. I will say this, though. The exact same year, though, Richard Roundtree was also in Rian Johnson's Brick.
Oh, good cool. Movie.
Same exact year. So, you know, he was making his way through here. And that's what, like, I kind of liked his career, his kind of like post career here and everything. Just doing these great little roles where he'll just kind of pop up, be in there for a little bit and then sneak on out, because Richard Roundtree is great to see.
Yeah, and he, you know, he'll do a million TV series. He comes in, does a pop in, walks out, and then occasionally Tarantino gives him a ring, and he's like, "Yeah, I'll be there."
Yeah, sure thing. Why not? I'll do that.
I mean, that's
a good way to be.
No, it's kind of the perfect career, isn't it?
In that same year, he was also in 5 episodes of Desperate Housewives. Mr. Roundtree, you keep chasing that dream, buddy.
Heck yeah, that guy's doing it. I love her special effects, like everything that like her running through the woods, which first of all, like I said, her running, all the running in this is hilarious. It's like she kind of starts with some good form, like her arms are doing the right thing, but you look at her legs and they're all incorrect. And I'm not like a wild runner or anything, but you can just, so many years watching Tom Cruise, you know how to do it perfect, you know?
Well, that's the problem is that they have massive Tom Cruise envy in this move, in this show.
Yeah, because I think that's fair. That's a good call.
But you can't pull it off.
She is cutting with the hand blades,
yeah, like the hand Tom blades Cruise does. But the thing is that she didn't watch is Cruise's footwork. His knees are so high when he's running, and that's what gives it that full kind of blast that's not here, and she just looks like a crazy lady who's trying to power walk at the mall.
With a cancer wig on.
Oh, man. She didn't have the wig till the end, though.
Well, no, that one's fine, but then everybody's trying to, but her like kind of matrix powers as she's walking through, and like the focused vision to see like this tree could poke you in the face or something.
I thought she was just having a migraine the way they showed it on screen. I thought she was having like a migraine there, and that's just what her vision was doing.
No, she was going through matrix mode, man. She was running like. There was something that they said that like all of a sudden she like kind of kicked it into high gear so she could run even faster than the dudes that were chasing her and shooting after and everything. She's running, and so she goes, boom, starts going even faster. And that's when we go into the matrix mode where she kind of sees everything, and all the running just gets like ridiculously slow. And it just feels like they're trying to pad out this movie so much.
What did you think about the sidekicks in the underground lair? Like, they had the kid that lives in the sewer and makes bugs out of old paper clips. They had the guy that kind of wanted to be a little bit like Donald Faison from Scrubs, I guess.
Well, yeah, I feel so bad for that actor, the African-American actor, because clearly being his role is being written by like 60-year-old guys who've never actually met a black guy before. There's a whole lot of that happening.
I wrote for you some real authentic black lines. Here you go.
You know, I was just recently watching an episode of Law and Order, and there was an African-American gentleman on there, and I took some of their lingo.
I like it. And you will too. Put it in this show. It was so bad. But like, the thing that's actually more distracting, at least about that, is that whole scene is one of the best scenes in this movie, only because it's like, why? Why did
you stop churching it up and calling this a movie? This ain't a movie.
You're right. It's a feature film.
It's a movie. Yes, this is a motion picture experience.
Cinema. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. But like that whole chess scene is one of the best scenes in this, because it is the biggest load of the camera is moving everywhere. They set up some dolly tracks, did some steady cam work and stuff, and it is all over the place. Like Michael Bay would look at this movie and go, calm down, just stop, it's a little bit much.
Were you guys able to keep up with how quickly things were happening in this movie?
How do you mean? It's an hour and a half and nothing happens. There's literally
it must be happening so quick you can't even see it, because I swear I couldn't really tell you what happened. I know Jane goes to Chechnya. She gets superpowers. A kid gives her a dung beetle made out of paper clips, and then the credits roll. And I think some people got shot, but nobody really cared. I know they tried to do a motorcycle chase scene, but they clearly didn't even have a stunt guy they could trust to do cool things on the motorcycle for the most part. So they just intercut like quickly scenes of a motorcycle going 25 miles an hour against an SUV also going 25 miles an hour. Like the editing on that chase scene really told me, like, they had access to a motorcycle and a car and a parking lot, but they didn't know what to do with it.
They also, this television show doesn't have the guts to have Richard Roundtree actually be the villain in the show. they wanted to make him the villain so very bad. And then I guess he said, yeah, I guess if this thing goes to series, I'll be part of it. And they were like, well, now you can't be the villain. So we'll make Tate Donovan the villain. And, you know, are you guys familiar with Tate Donovan at all?
I am not. I never watched like the OC and the kind of shows that I've seen listed on his filmography. So,
so that's where, is that where he's best known as is from?
He's the voice of Hercules in the Disney classic animated film feature Hercules.
Well, you know, the reason why I say this is because Tate Donovan is one of those guys where he is in some really massive things. Mm-hmm. You know, he's in Argo, he's in Shooter, he's in Manchester by the Sea. Like, he is in a lot of real honest to God movies. And he's not bad in any of those movies. Like, he's pretty good. And I know that he was a child actor because he started, like, I want to say on Family Ties. He did a walk-on on Family Ties.
Yep.
And so he's one of those guys where, like, he's just been around forever. And I don't know what the deal is here. Maybe he just works when he needs to, maybe. I'm not sure. But he's literally been in show business for 50 years.
Yeah, 116 credits says he's just a whatever comes, I'm going to be taking it and doing the best that I can with it from the looks of it.
Well, good for him, I guess.
But even doing like everything from like some shorts and stuff to it's kind of all over the place. But he's one of those character actors that when he shows up, you're like, oh, he'll be, you know, he's really good.
Yeah, I mean,
I didn't find him terribly memorable. The performance he gave us in this major motion picture.
Look at what he had to work with here. You know, you can.
There are no small roles, only small Tate Donovans.
Yeah, I suppose so. But at least he feels like he's trying in the role where some people
he is. Like, he is, and I mean, you know, he's one of those actors where, like, you know, he's totally fine. You know what he kind of reminds me of? He's sort of like on that same level of like a Thomas Jane, where, you know, Thomas Jane's going to come in, he's going to pitch five good innings for you, and then you got to pull him or his arm's going to get too tired and things are going to get bad. And so that's who Tate Donovan is to me. We're like, you know, he's going to be really great in the three scenes that you give him. You're going to give him one scene where he's really like chewing up the scenery because that's kind of who he is. And he's going to give you one of those steely, like I'm talking low and I'm saying something really awful to the main character. Like, he is that kind of actor. Whereas Thomas Jane is like, I am going to go as absolutely bonkers as I possibly can in this scene. And it's kind of the only difference between the two guys, but they look sort of alike. They have kind of the same careers where, like, they'll be in something big and then, like, they'll be in something where you're like, he's in that? Really?
Like, why did you go and do that?
But then you see him in it and you're like, wow, he's actually really great in that. Or, you know, like that kind of thing.
You know, now that you make that comparison, I'm kind of shocked Thomas Jane isn't in this movie.
Let's see, 2005, that Punisher had come out by then, yeah?
It might have been too confusing if Painkiller Jane is the name of it and he's not Jane.
Painkiller Thomas Jane? Ooh.
Give him the win.
Oh, my word, sir.
Well, in the world that we live in today where genders can be swapped, we have that in there. We put Thomas Jane in the main role, and there you have it. It's going to anger some people, I'm sure, but no one's going to watch it, just like this movie.
Somebody watch it. This is somebody's favorite movie. You got to remember that.
No way.
I don't know.
It's got one thumbs up, so somebody likes it.
Somebody has to, and I've kind of had that thought over the years of, like, whenever I'm watching something, even especially when it's particularly bad, to think somewhere, somebody, this is it. This is their jam. This is the movie that they go back to.
No way.
Not this particular movie in particular. I'm not saying there's somebody
with an organic brain injury. I mean, who knows the situation?
I'm not saying that there's a ton of those people. I'm saying there's like maybe one. Just like
what's an organic brain injury? You like hit a tree?
It's like Gary Busey.
I fell down a well. Like
if Gary Busey told you he thought this was his favorite film, you wouldn't be that surprised.
No, it's true. But also, like, I would hide my silverware.
Yeah.
The you know what? I just found Tate Donovan's best movie. He's in Good Night and Good Luck.
Yeah.
And
oh yeah,
that is like, that's a sweet Shaunzi top five right there. I love that movie.
Really?
I love.
There's hardly any kung fu in that movie.
Hardly.
There's
that one Edward R. Murrow roundhouse kick at the end.
You know, when he's talking to Lee Liberace, and
he knocked him right through the set wall. It was unbelievable.
So this movie, did they start making it without a script and then like finished it before they had a script also?
No, I think this was certainly well written out and everything and planned on. It was just,
I feel like nothing happened in this movie.
Well,
it
didn't.
This feels like even if it was a pilot episode, not a great pilot episode.
Oh, well, yeah. The problem is that you have to introduce all of these characters, right? And I know that sounds kind of hilarious, but you do have to introduce all of these other characters. And like you know that she's going to be hanging out and the good looking dudes like hang out with the
his underground dwelling,
right, with little Hogan from Hogan's Heroes, and so it's just,
but she's also got her own riptide boat, like they couldn't pick a lane for her lair.
Well, here is the thing is that like When she shows up, when she wakes up, wow, she does pass out a lot in the show.
She passes
out like four times in 2 hours.
They should call it Sleepy Time Jane. She's out like a light 3/4 of this movie.
Sleepy Time T Jane. So she like, you know, when she wakes up in that underground bunker, like, you know that you're going to be spending a whole lot of time there just because that's what this is.
Which, by the way, for as long as she's under in that little prison bunker and everything, still looking fabulous every single time. That makeup is just on point every single
full
day.
Full makeup.
God bless.
I like it that when she leaves, she takes a duffel bag filled with $100 bills. And the best I can tell, all she bought with it was a bus ticket, a leather jacket, and a haircut. Like she is not.
Don't forget that affliction T-shirt.
The sunglasses. But I mean, she has no sign of any leftover money when she's on that bus. Yeah,
maximum was $1,000 spent, and that's if you overspent.
$15 on that wig, as we know.
The wig was not on high price.
Even a conservative estimate, that duffel bag had at least $15,000 in it.
She probably spent the most money on the duffel bag.
But she didn't take the duffel bag.
That's right. That's right. She didn't buy that. She didn't buy that. That's right.
She didn't, but she didn't even take the duffel bag. She left the empty duffel bag with a note that said, "I'm sorry." And I guess she just ran out like Hamburglar with his arms full of hamburgers, but it's also stacks of hundreds. She probably dropped most of it on her way to the bus station.
That's all I like to get on buses, with armloads of cash.
But if you're going to steal $15,000, just steal the duffel bag too. Why would you leave the duffel bag behind?
Well, see, when you leave the duffel bag behind, what the thought process is with there is they'll go, "Oh, thank God, the duffel bag." They'll walk up to the duffel bag, unzip the duffel bag, see that there's nothing in it, and you've gained another four or 5 seconds. You know?
But that means that you got to fill up that duffel bag with Chinese newspapers.
I mean, maybe.
She'll say, you can always get more money, but duffel bags, those have sentimental value.
That's too good a duffel bag. I can't take that.
That was clearly given to him for free when he got his car washed somewhere.
Hell, that is a beautiful hockey bag. I can't take that.
Did you?
That's a real functional hockey bag.
Listen, I understand you donated $50 to NPR for this bag, and I don't want you to lose it either. There you go. Just keep it. Put some groceries in it. It's fine. I love, like, I'm sorry, I got to go back to the chess scene because like there's 10 minutes worth of this chess scene, and but we are zooming in and out. We are dolling in and out of everything. Why is that so over the top? And of course, she goes, "I've never played chess before," looks at the chessboard, and then not only does she know how to play chess, now she did mention, "I know how the pieces move," and I'm like, okay, that's fine. But as someone who also knows how the pieces move, I'm not very good at chess, but at least I do know how the pieces move. I don't know all the like, you know, C4 to 3-8 or whatever the hell any of that stuff is. But she knows that all of a sudden just by looking at the board that doesn't have any of those numbers on it. Love it.
You know,
are you saying that there's plot holes in this show?
Come on. We've all known somebody who went to Chechnya, got chemical weapons used on them, and then they were magically good at chess. It's not that much of a stretch.
Isn't that what that Netflix show is about?
Yeah, the Anya Taylor-Joy is Painkiller Jane, the reboot.
Well, it's a knockoff of Painkiller Jane, I think.
That's what I mean. Yeah. You know, it's a mockbuster.
Sometimes you have those ripoffs that come in and they're like, oh, we feel like we can make it a television series.
I can remember, I think I was in like the third episode of that show and I was like, geez, this is such a Painkiller Jane ripoff.
I did see that they marketed Queen's Gambit, the board game, and it was just a chessboard that had like Queen's Gambit, the board game on the box.
You know what I call that? Brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
That's a real Adam thing right there, where like the least amount of effort I can possibly do to try to make money.
Somebody would buy it. Somebody would absolutely just go like, I love Queen's Gambit. I need some chess. So chess, a game as old as time itself, not copyrightable. So I can make any kind of chess crap I want. Buy a $2, you know, thing, slap a sticker on it that says, you know, Queen's Gambit. Next thing you know, Adam's rolling in the Benjamins.
you missed that bus.
I tell you.
Do you have a Painkiller Jane chessboard?
It's actually a Painkiller Jane barbecue set.
I'm just going to sell some Tylenol, rewrap the label on it as Painkiller
Jane. Oh, Painkiller Jane ibuprofen.
Just take 4 or 7 or something.
Just a fistful of chess. Them and you'll be A-okay. Yeah, a fistful of Painkiller Jane ibuprofen and you'll be fantastic at chess. I'm telling you, these things just start writing themselves. I do love, but like during that chess game, though, that's when that is like the one weird area where all the references started coming out. It felt like maybe if anything was written on the day, Bruce, it was that kind of stuff where it's like, oh, we got to put something in here. Let's put in some neat references so we sound really cool. A Biggie Tupac reference. Yeah, that'll get him.
Well, it is 2005. You know, that style hasn't gone completely away. I mean, you know, you're going to have those moments.
Yeah.
It strangely feels like the humor on back when I used to watch Law & Order. Like, that does feel like a Law & Order joke.
The Law and Order joke goes through SpongeBob's and Super Mario Brothers?
They make him extremely dated and not that funny. I'm telling you, go back and watch.
Also, it's like a Robin Williams stand-up special.
Ooh. Yeah, go watch like circa 1998 early years Law and Order and then just watch on through until you're done with it. You'll see some weird jokes like that.
Oh, that's all it takes? Just that amount of time?
And then, you know, you'll die of old age.
Yeah, you'll die of old age, but you will do it humorless and it'll be great. Without a laugh on your face. I didn't understand.
So at the end, when she goes to the mall, because this all has a showdown at the mall, because they're like, you know, the malls aren't quite dead yet, so we're still going to put them in this major motion picture.
The mall kind of, like, honestly, that was one where I was surprised at how everything looked as good as it did. It looked like they got a real good, proper mall that was in working order, you know, at the
time.
They
stole that shot. They just went to the local mall in Vancouver.
I can tell you, as someone who has stolen shots at a mall before, that is incredibly difficult to do.
We'll meet us outside of Dillard's. Like
the guy in the trench coat that's the shooter, like, I felt like we should have known him or something. Like, was he just introduced to be the shooter at the mall, or did I miss his introduction earlier in the movie?
I don't even know what you're talking about right now. So I'm going to say that was his introduction.
Yeah. There's a guy in a trench coat shooting people at the mall and she like has to take a bullet to save Richard Roundtree.
Oh yeah.
And
at first,
because we've never seen this guy, I'm like thinking, did the creepy kid from the sewer become a traitor? Like, I thought he was the one shooting at her because the shooter has on a trench coat. And the only person I've seen in a black trench coat in this movie so far is the creepy kid from the sewer. But this guy was clearly older than the creepy kid from the sewer once we got a look. But they treat it like I should care about who this guy is instead of him being a random shooter at the mall.
Didn't
Because he's supposed to be attached with the main bad guy who I honestly think was who he's like, you know, he says he's this doctor so-and-so. Mm-hmm. And then later on, it's revealed that he's actually the bioterrorist. Mm-hmm. I honestly think that they filmed significant portions of this movie with him being Dr. So-and-so.
Oh, for sure.
Which does not play smoothly at all.
Absolutely. I really do think that they learned that Richard Roundtree, like, they're like, oh, well, Richard Roundtree really does want to do it. Oh, okay. Then we'll just rewrite it. That's really what that all felt like.
And the real Dr. So-and-so, I think all they cast is like a stock photo. I don't think we actually, do we ever get to meet the real Dr. So-and-so? Or do we?
No, he's just in photographs.
Nothing like Tate Donovan, nothing at all.
I thought it was just like one of those situations a la Die Hard where he just kind of sees a name and a face up on a thing and just goes like, all right, that's going to be me kind of things.
This guy was a notable, like, doctor with the CDC or the university or something. And 2005 is not the Stone Age. I know for a fact you could Google stuff in 2005.
No.
So if you're going to be Dr. So-and-so and you don't look like Dr. So-and-so, you got to do some covering your butt there.
Bruce, 2005 was a long time ago. Google wasn't out. I don't know what you're talking about.
I Googled lots of Dr. So-and-sos in 2005.
Give me my closest Dr. So-and-so, will you?
Yeah.
Just to see.
And also I Googled bioterrorists. They were on Google back then too.
What's Dr. So-and-so do? General practice.
Would have been great if she was trying to look him up and she found the bioterrorist MySpace, because MySpace was still kicking.
Oh, that would be a great little MySpace kind of ad in there. I always love to see those kind of. I'm going to sign into my new MySpace account. And she just goes on. I already got a friend. His name's Tom. It's great.
You're it's like, terrible that they closed down Napster. Now I have to get all my music from LimeWire. This is awful. Like, they needed some good 2005 references.
Some more of that in there. But like you said, when she goes to jump in front of Richard Roundtree to save his life, all I could think of is like, this 98-pound woman is going to get this bullet's going to go straight through her and kill him. She's so tiny that's like, it's great that it's not going to hurt you and perhaps it'll slow it down a little bit, but that bullet's still hitting him.
And let's be honest, Richard Roundtree at this point in his career looks like a guy who could probably take a bullet or two and
exactly.
be all right.
Exactly. But then again, if you've got a nice, sweet lady to take the bullet for you and slow it down a little bit before it gets to you, all the better, I guess.
How reliable is Deadline as a source?
They're pretty good. I would say they've had a very consistent run over these many years.
Because they're telling me, man, that Jessica Chastain will play the next version of Painkiller Jane. I just don't know if she can top this.
Well, it's true. She's got some big shoes to fill.
Once you get to the, you know, the top rung, where do you go from there?
She's got some big boot cut jeans to fill.
All right. Before we get to our final grade, we have to ask ourselves a very important question. How does this movie relate back one-to-one with Sylvester Stallone?
Thank you, Adam. I have a prepared statement. A very good eve to you, Mr. Stallone. I'd like to speak with you about Howard Blank, who was an associate producer on Painkiller Jane. After looking through his filmography, I can tell you that Howard Blank has been on a good many things on a film set. Like, for instance, on Blade Trinity, he was the casino technical advisor. On Josie and the Pussycats, he was the live audience coordinator. And on Rocky IV, he was a production assistant. Mr. Stallone, do you remember Rocky IV? Why did you make the original cut of that movie 2.5 hours long? Why is 30% of that movie montages? And why did you reject the song Peter Cetera had written for Rocky IV? It was Glory of Love, the song that they ended up using for Karate Kid 2. Instead, you decided to go with the song Hearts on Fire by John Cafferty. Did you really listen to both songs and say to yourself, my God, that Cafferty song slaps? What were you thinking? Look, I'm sure you have dozens of regrets marrying Brigitte Nielsen, the time you threatened physical violence to a few critics on television, the interview you gave Rolling Stone in 1982 when you said your womanizing days were over, the pudding empire you attempted to create in 2005, but not picking Glory of Love, that's got to be up there. Now, I realize at this point, I haven't really spoken much about the Stallone connection this week, Howard Blank, and I'm okay with that. And there you have it, Mr. Stallone, this week's Stallone connection. I'll talk to you next week. Your pal, Sweet Shaunzy from the internet.
Well, here at Hero Movie Podcast, we have our own patented Robin rating system. Bruce, where does Painkiller Jane from 2005 fall on the Robin rating system for you?
I hope somebody likes it better than I did. I felt like it was a really, really long trailer for a movie I don't want to see, maybe. It was boring to me, man. I felt like nothing happened. I felt like nothing happened. So I've got to give it the old Stephanie Brown.
That's fair enough. Sean?
To me, this is like watching an episode of Hunter. except for like Hunter has like undefinable superpowers. Like that's kind of what this show felt like to me. And it wasn't something that I hated. It's just something that is innocuous. Like it's just there. I like a couple of the actors on this show. But you know, it's a Stephanie Brown, this thing. It's not good. It's not great. It's middle. It's lower middle. It's a Stephanie Brown.
For me, it's all the sentiments are the same. It feels to me like they gave it their best, and their best was not super great, but God bless them, they tried. And it didn't feel like something that was bound to be, you know, to go on further than what it was. But it's mostly, I think, because while you've got a couple of fine people in there, like you said, there's nothing really that's that standout element. When you think of Painkiller Jane, is there anything other than you think, oh, this girl can take a couple of bullets to her and they heal up real quick? It's like, oh, okay, great. Well, what else? Nothing really else. That's just about it. Oh, she wears a red wig, and that's super fun. But the thing is it's not. It's not really all that fun. It is just middling. But at least within writing all of my kind of breakdown and stuff like that, I had enough fun just looking at it, how stupid it was. Didn't pass the phone test to save its life, I'll tell you that.
No, this right definitely now does not pass the phone test at all.
And for being like an hour and really, 20 minutes, you know.
And really, if you have good Wigdar, this television show is going to make you very angry by the third act.
Or it might make you really happy. Like maybe you like looking at bad wigs.
Oh, yeah. It could be. If you're a fan of bad wigs, then you are in luck.
Oh, I'm like one of the, I love spotting them and stuff. There's one girl right now. I cannot remember her name, but she's very famous right now. She's a very pretty lady, but like I her hair, I don't know if it's her hair or not, but like it looks like just the worst wig ever. And I'm like this poor young girl. She looks so beautiful when this hair is just, but everyone loves the hair. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't get it. I don't understand hair. My grade is Damian Wayne, right in the middle. It's okay. Wasn't terrible, wasn't great, but I certainly no need to watch again. But boy, I can't wait till we get to that next Painkiller, Jane, because I hear that's when they do it just right.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we'll wait on that. So that will do it, everybody, for this episode of Hero Movie Podcast. We're going to talk about what we'll watch in just a moment for next week. But Bruce, where can we find more of your work on the internet?
I'd love for people to check out the YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/Bruce Leslie. All kinds of cool stuff going on. I'm going to look over some of the stellar comments from part two of the final season of Attack on Titan in a video coming out the same day that this here podcast episode is coming out. So go check it out. There's fun stuff over there.
Sean, what else?
We got another show called Moon Knight 30 Questions, where each week we ask 30 questions of the latest episode of Moon Knight, and we are going to be recording that right after we record this one.
And of course, you can check out the Film Find as well. And remember, for our supporters over at patreon.com/HMP, do you remember that you are voting on what we're watching this week? We'll keep the vote up until probably about Wednesday evening. We'll kind of cut it there just so we can have enough time to watch and do all the preparation for the show that we have to do. But let's go over those one more time here. We've got Super Fuzz, Super Bob. That's available on Tubi. Ultraman Geed, the movie, the Connect the Wishes. The best title we'll hear all week, oh, for sure. That's on Netflix. The Marvel Japanese Spider-Man episodes 1-3, that is available on archive.org. And Defender with Woody Harrelson, also available on Tubi. So you do have those movies to vote on, patreon.com/HMP. And let us know in the comments section what your choice is and why you chose it and stuff like that. And we'll read all that kind of fun stuff on the air next week. That is it, everybody. Join us next week when we're talking your Patreon selection for Sweet Sean's and Kovacs from the Internet. Bruce Leslie, I'm Adam Portress. Stay super, everybody.
Bye, Marty and Amy.